And we are live. Welcome to Beastly Thoughts, episode 3.
152.
Episode 3, yes.
More than one.
What's going on, guys? How's your week been?
Been awesome, man. It's been really, really good.
Good. Glad to hear it. Beastly, we missed you last week. How you been?
Oh, man, I'm so happy to be back. You know, last week, that awful holiday where kids are eating candy and there's eggs everywhere. Mm-hmm. That's all gone behind me now. I'm very happy to be back. This week that just went by was a nightmare for me. I've been very, very busy in my office. Really haven't had too much of a chance to do too much gaming at home, but I have been spending a little bit more time with my Switch, and I got to say how much I'm really enjoying that console. It's been really amazing, and I'm super happy to be back. You guys did an excellent job last week.
We know.
Yes. You did a great job. Very happy to be back.
You know, one of the great things about bringing Gary on is that it gives us that fourth host that we've always wanted, right? Is we always had the problem. If one person couldn't make it, then it was a two-man show. And now finally we have that. We have that flexibility. So thank you again, Gary, for joining the cast.
My pleasure, gentlemen.
So a little bit of the pressure off, you know? Like,
yeah,
somebody can just not show up, you know? Like, you had a family issue, and that's great, you know? And we can just go ahead and do the show. It feels good. Feels good,
and
man.
Plus now if you or I leave, there's another adult. So you can make adult jokes and not worry about offending Robbie.
Took me a moment there.
You know, yeah. Because, you know, back in the day when you make those adult jokes, I could see Robbie squeeze his Play-Doh. He just didn't know how to deal with it. But it's great to have another adult on the show.
Jesus.
Jin.
Gary, what have you been up to this week?
Put me on the spot there. Well, this week I have had a resurgence, almost a renaissance, let's say, in the hardware that I've been playing. I'm late to the party, but I think it's
really
the best time.
Very late.
Fashionably late. I'd say this is the best time to join the party. I've actually picked up this little bad boy right here.
Sexy, man.
There you go. For those of you who aren't aware of what that is the PS Vita Slim. I picked it up this week, imported from Japan, with a nice 32GB memory card, and I have been having a whale of a time exploring what the system can do and the games library. So it's really an amazing proposition, I've got to say. I know, are we all PS Vita owners here?
I think everybody here owns one. Robbie, did you sell yours?
I sold mine, yeah, about a year ago. I love the system. It's just, nothing on it. So
right.
It was sad. I was sad to do it, but yeah, I just wish there was more games for it.
So I guess I'm not going to teach you guys how to suck eggs with it, but for anyone listening who's not aware of what the PS Vita was, it was the handheld that Sony released way back in quarter one 2012. It was positioned to be console quality graphics on the go, and really I think it's delivered on that promise the more and more that the machine has matured. Proposition really is an immense library of games, PS1, PSP and indie backward compatibility, as well as remote play for your PS4 and selected PS3 titles. To me, I feel like the Switch coming out this year has created a renaissance or resurgence in interest in portable gaming in the West. Because in Japan, it never really went away. But I feel like in the West, there's been a significant drop off in people that want to play portable.
So in the West, consoles. At least in the US, it's never gone away. It's just that the DS dominated that market, right?
Yeah.
In the US, that's how it is, right? Is the Vita was cool. And it was more powerful, and to, you know, adult gamers, I think it was compelling. But when you compare it to Nintendo and the DS and Pokemon and Mario and Zelda, it could never compete. It just, the Vita did a better job, or I'm sorry, the PSP did a better job than the Vita did.
Yeah.
Now I'm going to shed a European lens on the Vita and maybe perceptions of success. So I went and did some digging around sales stats, and it's actually the 20th best-selling console / handheld of all time, above the Wii U, which is interesting. The console sold, stats are a bit vague, but at least 15 million units, so between 15 to 20 million units, of which only 2 were sold in the US. So you guys have only got 2 million units sold in the US as time of there. Mm-hmm. Put that in perspective in Japan and Europe.
Yeah.
Over 10 to 12 million were sold there. So in Japan and Europe.
Do you have a breakdown for Europe and?
Yeah, sure. I mean, we've got around 6 million in Japan, the rest being in Europe. So probably about 4.5 million in Europe, maybe 5 somewhere around
that.
So
that's a lot more successful. I wonder why the disparity.
So it's partly to do with the style of games that went out. And you hear a lot of people immediately say the Vita has no games. And that's something that's thrown around all the time.
Yeah, that's not necessarily true. It's just maybe it doesn't appeal to the American market. That's what it really is. It's a JRPG machine and indie machine. That's why people just didn't care, at least over here.
So, interestingly enough, on that point, did a bit more digging as well and looked at exactly what the game library stood at right now as of Q1 2017, moving into Q2. We've actually got 1,545 games published and available right now on the Vita, of which 908 are available in English. Now, the device itself is region-free. So as long as the game is in English, assuming that's the language you speak, you can play it. Mm-hmm. You've got 908 games available. As you say, Robbie, some of them may well be heavily led on the JRPG, the visual novel, the dungeon crawler, and the Monster Hunter grind kind of game. But that's not to say there's not a huge range of great games out there to play.
Let me ask you, Gary, though. Like, I know this is a specific question, but are there any games that really pertain to my taste? You know, something about panties.
There's actually a lot of games that pertain to panties. I think you're
just waiting for that question, anticipating it. Thank you, Brian.
I think we had a prop right here, actually, which is the
oh god,
the Gal Gun Collector's Edition, which
this is insane.
Comes with a
the phone,
a screen cleaner.
Which, what a weird shape for a screen cleaner.
Yeah, man.
Interesting screen cleaner you got there, Gary.
For those people that are listening in on the podcast, this
whose
is
whose screens are you cleaning here, Gary? We want to know.
His laptop screen.
For the people that are listening on the podcast, the Vita has some interesting limited editions, some of which we've just demoed had props from the game where you were photographing girls in different states of undress. But moving on from that point, talking about games and support moving forward, the Vita's a machine which is still supported in 2017. There's actually 119 games coming out in 2017 in English for the system, 12 this month. So the Switch is not supported that heavily at the moment. You can't say that there's going to be 12 games releasing in April for the Switch. And also there's, I guess if you're a collector, this machine has hardware, you know, the games that come out for this piece of hardware generally have limited editions. They have art books, you know, collectible pins, things of that nature. You know,
panties.
Are you mostly panties. Finding this stuff from Japan?
No, not at all. So NIS America and NIS Europe, for people out there, they're a publisher that are massively supporting the Vita. If you go onto their website, you'll find 10 to 15 collector's editions available to pre-order right now and get out for games like Persona, Demon Gaze, Dragon's Crown, Gal Gun, Valkyrie Drive, anything of that nature are all there. Grand Kingdom, things, you know, anything that you can think of that's popular is available to buy there. You've also got companies like Limited Run, which are doing a fantastic job, and I've got to plug them there. Limited Run, not just for the Vita, but actually do it for the PS4, Switch, Wii U. They take games that are digital only, that have a huge following, things like Shovel Knight at the time, Rainbow Moon, and they will put out a physical boxed copy of the game, and they'll number it, they'll do 5,000 copies and push it out. Yeah, they're doing that on a monthly basis, supported by fans. $25, $30, I think, for a digital-only game that you can actually have a physical copy of and hold. And they're massively supporting the Vita.
Those type of games, though, are what kind of keeps the Vita alive, right? When the Vita was first announced and, like, when I first bought it, what I thought I was going to get was something that, wow, it's got dual joysticks, so I can play first-person shooters. Call of Duty could be on a portable. We had an Uncharted come to it. Like, I thought we were going to be getting these, like, big AAA games, but on a portable. I was really excited about it. That fizzled out very quickly.
Yeah,
as years went on, some of my favorite games over the last 5 or 6 years have actually been on Vita. Things like Rogue Legacy, things like Guacamelee, things like, you know, like that type of experience. Shovel Knight, like you noticed before, or you said before.
Yeah.
But it's hard to justify, like, those games are available on, like, every console.
Every
that's the problem.
That's what, for me, is so hard to justify about recommending a Vita.
So I guess I've got a couple of points on there. One about the games library, as you said, and people finding a place to purchase games. The attach rate on the Vita for developers and why indie developers are drawn to the Vita, the attach rate is at least triple that of its nearest competitor in terms of software sales. Mm-hmm. For people that aren't familiar with attach rate, that's the number of pieces of software at the general consumer, the average consumer buys when they buy a piece of hardware. So in the case of the PS4 and Xbox, the latest stats that went out put it between 4 to 6. So the average person who buys a PlayStation 4 or Xbox purchases between 4 to 6 pieces of software. On the Vita, the last time that stat was communicated was in 2014. So it's moved on since then. And it was placed anywhere between 11 to 15.
Holy hell.
The people that buy the Vita buy games with it. And they like to buy games. They like to play games. They like to have large libraries. To your point, Briar, about lack of AAAs and people looking at indies, that's really the perfect storm that led to the demise of the Vita. So there's four factors, I guess, that why we don't see the Vita all over the shelves in the West and why it didn't succeed. And I think it's fair to put counterbalance to my argument around why I think it's a great time to buy it, and you know why maybe you haven't seen it around. That's poor AAA support. So you mentioned games like Resistance, Call of Duty, FIFA, Madden that came out. Most AAA games that released in the first year of the Vita's life were terrible, terrible ports.
Horrible. My God.
They were.
You mentioned two of the Resistance game and Call of Duty Black Ops Declassified.
Oh, they were rough.
Games that I was really excited for because, you know, Briar and I were new to the Vita. We were excited about the prospects of what they were going to bring to this little handheld. And when they released these games, it just completely diminished my hopes of having console quality experiences on the go. I felt like they'd completely dropped the ball when it came to AAA experiences because every opportunity they had, they seemed to just poop it away. It just really made no sense for me. All these people wanted these experiences on the go and they had crappy developers make poor renditions of AAA games. And
even
that's
compared
all
to the PSP where you at least had, you had the God of War games, you had Luminous, you had some
great,
really strong titles
Those
for the
great,
PSP.
Dude.
That I feel like that, like, there are good experiences on the Vita, don't get me wrong. I really believe that. And like, if you can get one cheap, I think it's a great way to go. But moving forward, I can't imagine recommending one of these things with the Switch out.
Yeah.
So again, with the Switch out now, I think it's the perfect time to recommend one. And the reason I say that, the argument being, is that there's still such an active and lively community and still so many developers supporting it that if you want games which you're not going to find on the Switch and you want exclusives that the PS Vita can bring and you're into the type of games that encompasses, which are indie games, RPGs or JRPGs and more broad RPGs, dungeon crawlers, tactical games and Monster Hunter clones. All of these you will not find on the Switch and you won't find
the adult
themed.
Don't you think you will though next year? Maybe, you know,
yeah, give it time. Like, the system just came out.
As like, I feel like we're watching the sunset for the PS Vita and the sunrise for the Switch. Like, if you're going to be an indie developer on a small scale, like, aren't you going to, wouldn't you rather get your game on the Switch?
I think for indies, you're probably spot on with your analysis. But I think on the visual novels, the tactical RPGs, the dungeon crawlers, the JRPGs, none of those you're going to see on the Switch because it's just not, they're not family friendly. So
Monster Hunter is a Nintendo. It was on the Wii U. So Monster Hunter, it'll definitely come to the Switch.
So certainly Monster Hunter may well, there's been no confirmation on it, but it may well, but you won't get things like God Eater, Tokaiden, anything of that nature, which are kind of evolutions and progressions, Freedom Wars, you know, Trials of Cold Steel. These sorts of games they've taken the Monster Hunter ethos and really evolved them and taken them forward. Monster Hunter, I guess, has seen prominence in the West and people see it as a paradigm of the genre because the West has adopted it. It's not necessarily the best game in the Hunter genre.
Oh, no, it probably isn't, even though Monster Hunter, the last one that came out on the 3DS and on the Wii U, saw critical acclaim. My son's still playing like crazy today. The thing is, as generations move forward, games change, they evolve. Like, you know, in the initial Monster Hunter games that came out years ago, they were kind of the beginning of this whole genre. And then you have God Eater come out, and you have all these other clone type of experiences come out and change the formula and kind of grow and do different things with that particular game style. There's no reason that we wouldn't think that Monster Hunter wouldn't do the same thing in its next iteration and maybe reclaim the crown and do more innovative things with this next rendition of the game. So to me, it's wide open. You know, I think it's a great possibility. But if personally, I have my PlayStation Vita is on the charger right now. I was playing it this morning with my daughter. I think it's a great console. I think its time has come and gone. And now that something like the Switch exists, I honestly, there's no way in hell I would ever tell someone to buy a Vita over a Switch.
Switch just is in a weird place, though, right? It's like the Switch is really cool and it's an awesome piece of kit, but there's no fucking games.
The software is very worrying for
it's
the Switch.
Very limited, limited right now. It's a it's a launch lineup. Hopefully, you know, the virtual console comes out soon. Hopefully, you know, we get Mario next week or on Friday of this week. You know, hopefully that improves by the end of the year, but it can be frustrating.
I mean, completely take your points on it, and I think to each their own on the handheld market. For me, I see it as a library of games that are available and still a steady stream of the type of games that I'm into. Mm-hmm. So for me, it's a no-brainer. You can pick them up relatively cheaply now. Granted, the memory cards themselves form a bit of a stumbling block.
$1,000 a piece, yeah.
They are expensive.
What?
I'm just kidding.
No,
right?
No, they're not.
$1,000 a piece.
You can pick up a 64 gig, which were exclusive to Japan, for somewhere in the region of about $95 to $100. You can pick up a 32 gig for about $70, but that's your buy-in. Mm-hmm. So once you've bought in on that, you're in for the long haul. To close on it, I guess, like I said, I kind of talked about the perfect storm that led to the ultimate downfall and why it didn't see the prominence that it deserved.
Yeah.
One of those parts was the poor AAAs that came out. The second part was one of the most compelling aspects of the Vita, which is remote play on the PS4. Mm-hmm. Let's remember that this was launched in Q1 2012, with the PS4 launching in Q4 2013. So that's almost a full 2 years where it didn't have one of the staples of this handheld and something which really defined it. So that's something, you know, poor timing there. And then finally, I guess the rise in mobile gaming, which no one could have anticipated. So in the West, people started using their phones in 2012 onwards to be gaming platforms. So you saw a demise in the prominence of the handheld. So those things all together, you know, poor AAAs, no remote play, and a rise in dominance of the handheld really didn't let the Vita shine where it should have. But I think if you're looking for an amazing platform to remote play your PS4, to play JRPGs, tactical games, visual novels, and game experiences you won't get anywhere else, really mature, adult, Japanese-oriented games,
panties.
Still a great time. Panties, indeed. Still a great
panties
time to pick up.
The
I had to say it right then.
And that's where I'll leave my point. I'm having fun with it. I've got 40 games that I've bought this week for the Vita, at least. It's
a lot,
you know,
of games.
He's not lying, guys. You guys follow Gary on Twitter.
I'm going to give you guys a visual aid for the people here in the thing. This is the current lineup, and there's more on the way.
Oh my
god! Just come this week.
You just got the thing.
I'm completely converted, a huge advocate of it, and would recommend anyone that has a similar taste to me, if you've been listening to the podcast in games, hit me up. I'll happily give you a whistle-stop tour of the best things to find. But yeah, expect more Vita games moving forward. I'll be talking about them, hopefully multi-plats, so you're not limited to it. But yeah, I'm going to close on that.
Well, Gary, let me just say this, because pre-show we were talking about getting together, playing some games in VR. If you got some games that you can play multiplayer online, shoot me a message on Twitter and I'll play with you. I got a majority of the games that you showed, what I saw on Twitter anyway. So if you want to get together with the Beastly Gamer, you know, after hours, wink, wink, then we can play together.
Late night.
I look forward to playing with you late night.
You know, it'll be past your bedtime, Robbie.
Oh yeah, anyway. Sure. I'll be in bed. You know,
you're
I'm
talking
just a
about
kid,
Robbie
right.
is up like he is going to bed when we're waking up, Beastly.
Yeah, he does.
Hey, yeah. I mean, sometimes for sure.
But yeah, thanks guys. That was it for me. Played a lot of other games, but I really wanted to use my my segment to talk about the Vita in 2017. So
How much does the Vita cost these days?
Oh, you can get it for like 120.
It depends what you want. So the coloured ones that I got here, which I would strongly recommend. So these coloured ones are not just a cosmetic change, the Slims. I've also got some analog extenders on them for people that are watching this here. The white, neon orange, red and aqua blue which you can import from Japan for around $170, $160, have a matte body. And they also have a, well, I guess the micro USB is common, but the matte body on a handheld means if you're OCD like myself with fingerprints, you don't get them. And the console itself also sits in the hand a lot more comfortably. So yeah, for $160, you can import one from Japan and any color that you want, so long as it's one of the four I mentioned.
I don't really like gloss finishes on any electronics. Like it drives me crazy.
Oh my God.
You see every speck of dust on it. You see every fingerprint. Like matte finish, please, for everything.
It only looks good when you take it out of the box. And after that, it's over.
Yeah.
It's a wrap.
Yeah, completely agree. Yeah.
I also purchased that charging grip there, which gives it an 8-hour battery life. Forgot to mention that. But 8 hours on a handheld is pretty
That's pretty good. You know,
nice. Pretty solid.
The version 2 of that Vita, that slim Vita, like you have, it's a comfortable handheld to use. It's a really nice handheld. The first one was terrible. It's like a finger torture device, but the second one was really nice.
Every time I hear you say that, Briar, I laugh because I remember the frustration when you were playing Guacamelee and you were telling me trying to play.
It was like my hands would like cramp into like, I felt like I had lobster hands.
Yeah, you look like a lobster. Oh, yeah. That's the one I still have, guys. I'm behind the times, but everybody else has slims. And Gary, let me just say this quickly. A lot of what you said, I completely agree with. I love my Vita. I think I always will. It just seems like it was the perfect storm of things that happened that led to the demise of the console. It seemed like Sony stopped supporting it. They stopped talking about it. And really, there was no foreseeable AAA type of experiences coming. And I enjoy indies. You know, I like games that come through word of mouth, but I also like big blockbuster experiences, and having those on the go, to me, was a perk of having a portable console. That's why I think the Switch is so amazing.
You know what's messed up is my Vita. I couldn't honestly tell you where it is right now, but my PSP is still sitting on my bedside, charged up.
Oh, wow.
It's still charged up. Can you believe that? That's just because I'm addicted to Street Fighter Alpha. Like, I love to just pop that in, play a couple matches, and then put it down again. It's like a permanent home right next to my bed.
Since we're on the topic of portables and we're kind of going through what we've been playing, I told you guys it's been really slow for me. I've been busy at work during the pre-show. But The Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild has been a gift that keeps on giving. You know, previously in the last few weeks when we talked about it, I had very little time to kind of get into it.
We were all intimidated. We didn't want to talk about it anymore because of all the hate that Robbie was giving us.
And let me just say this, Robbie, you all messed up, man. I don't know what's wrong with you up there. I thought you people were nice. I've been playing Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild.
You were wrong about that.
And yeah, you got that right.
Now we're all nice? You really think that?
It is really a special kind of experience. And now I'm really starting to grasp the whole idea that Gary's kind of put out there. He said it's its own genre. He said it's his genre all to itself. And I really didn't understand what he meant. But there's so many aspects of this game. There's so many things that you can do. It's like everything you've ever done in an RPG kind of exists here. It feels like it's done better here, and there's still more to do. It's one of those things where every time you go around a corner, there's something incredible for you to do, something for you to find, something for you to, you know, for you to create a formula out of or try cooking it or fight a boss a certain new way. It's really special to me. I'm very happy with it. I've been playing it all around my house. You know, me and the girl sat in here and played it yesterday for about an hour and a half. Then I went into the living room and played for an hour. I went into the bedroom, played for about 45 minutes before I went to sleep. It's just a very special experience. And having that on the go is just, it's a blessing to me. It's an incredible experience. Sometimes I don't know what I like better, the Switch or that game. Because that game is so amazing, man.
I don't know if the Switch could have launched with a better game.
No, yeah. I don't think so. I can't remember a better launch game. I really can't remember one that... I can think of some that are in the same tier. Mario 64, of course, Super Mario World. There are certain games that exist in that same tier, but very few. And to me, it's the cream of the crop type of experience. I just can't believe they were able to extract all that in their first round. Right. And when you see how big this game is, all the stuff you can do and the quality of the image and all these things that are going on, it's really hard for me to believe they packed all that into this little tiny cartridge. You know, that's one thing I keep saying too. How in the hell is all this on this little tiny cartridge? Technology is just amazing nowadays, man. And magic. I'm an old man, so yeah, that's what it feels like. It's like YouTube magic.
So it's magic. Basically, do you agree as well, basically, talking about the game being in its own genre? I've heard it referred to over the past couple of weeks. There's a new term being bandied around saying that it's not an open world game. It's an open air game. And I found that really interesting because the distinction with that is that you've actually got verticality in a way that you've had with no other games. It's not just like open world. You've got the air around you because you can climb and leap from it. You can, the entire space is yours to experience and play with.
It's like an open world slash God game. It's like every aspect of this game is explorable. You can go anywhere that you see. I haven't seen any limits yet. And I've been, I'll probably put close to 20 hours into the game. And you're right. It is kind of an open air slash open world game. You climb to the top of a mountain and you can just, glide to another mountain. And all of a sudden you're having an experience right there as well. So it's a special game. It really is. And if you guys can't afford a Switch.
It's almost always worth it, too. Climbing to the top of that mountain is almost always worth it.
Yeah. It's really great, man. And let me just say this. If you guys are going to get a Switch later on this year, or if you can't get one this year and you have a Wii U, I would say get this game. Even on the Wii U, it's an incredible game.
Sure. It's really good on the Wii U.
It really needs to be played. It's one of those experiences. Everybody's been talking about it for weeks. I've been in and out of it. I play an hour or two here or there, but I'm really into it now, and it's an incredible game, guys.
There's an interesting sort of quickfire game as well, which I'd like to buzz around us here on Legend of Zelda. It's, I guess, the most mild of mild spoilers. So if you want zero spoilers for Zelda, I guess 15 seconds, please dial out. It's the most mild of mild. But the game, obviously, you can approach it in any way you want. What would be interesting to know is four words to know which journey you took through the game, really. I'm going to say, for me personally, it was elephant, camel, bird, lizard. So did anyone else have that? What did you have, Briar?
I have had elephant so far.
Only elephant?
Yeah.
Shit. Some casuals in this podcast. Robbie, what about yourself?
I think you just spoiled something major for me. I have no idea what you're talking about.
Oh, really?
Zero.
No wonder you don't you don't understand the game, Robbie. I've only gone through the elephant as well.
You're only elephant. Okay.
Elephants. But I'm headed toward the that's where I'm going now, the camel.
That's where I'm at, too. Literally just outside the camel.
I don't know.
But I
can see those humps. I like the humps. I'm a black guy. But it's an incredible game. And that elephant, to me, those puzzles, that adds so much to the game. It's done in such an incredible way. So thought-provoking, the way that they do these little puzzles and the way that you find these particular areas inside these, I guess what we call them, giant cauldrons. The game is fucking sick. It really is. Man. There's really nothing else like it. It's incredible.
Nothing that's been keeping me from playing that game except for time. There's nothing about the game itself that has made me put it down. It's literally although I will say this, I wish I hadn't bought all the
amiibos
because I find that I cannot start playing the game without doing the amiibos, and that is a half hour process. So it's do I have time to do that? Just play something else for now.
Wow,
I wish I had just never bought them. I wish I had never bought them. Because now I feel like every time I boot it up, I have to do the amiibos to get my value out of those fucking amiibos.
Talking amiibos, do you guys see the Monster Hunter Stories amiibos? I don't know if you guys follow amiibo news as much as I do, obviously. It's like a tax to me. But the three Monster Hunter Stories amiibos that have currently only been released in Japan, there's no word if they're coming out to the West or not. To get the three amiibos is $250.
You gonna get it, Gary?
I'm debating it at the moment. It's up in the air.
Now, a lot of people don't know who watch the show or listen to the podcast. You have every amiibo, right?
Except those at the moment, but it's eating away at my OCD inside me.
You guys let Gary know how hardcore he is in the comments below. My God.
Yeah.
That's something else.
Robbie, have you been up to?
Rob Skull.
I haven't really been playing much this weekend. Even now that we're talking about Zelda, this makes me think about it more too. I feel like for a while now, I don't know what it is, but I'm just not. Maybe it's open world games. I don't know what it is. I think I'm just starting to feel burnt out on games lately. There's been nothing for months now that I've just been interested in. I just find myself playing games less and less right now. And every game that comes out, nothing really grabs me. Even Zelda, I thought it was really fun, but I dropped it really quick. And
that happens though, Robbie. I've had that happen. It's actually lasted longer than months, or it's lasted for years for me. Or it's suddenly not so much on the video games right now.
Yeah, my passion for gaming
really
want to
be chasing that tail.
It feels like it's quiet right now, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know. I feel like my passion for games is just, it's waiting to be reignited right now. You know what I mean?
It's
like
going to happen, Robbie. It'll happen.
No, it will, I'm sure. But right now I'm just feeling kind of low and I'm like, I don't know. There's just something that's not getting me going about gaming. Like I usually am so excited. I just lately, I don't know what it is. It's just
springtime also not sometimes it. Do that to me. It's like all winter I've been kind of huddled up in my house, like hiding from the cold, playing a shit ton of video games. And then all of a sudden it's nice outside and I sit in front of a TV. I'm like, I don't really want to be here. I want to be outside.
That's the thing too. I've been doing other stuff. I've been going out.
There's no shame in what you're saying, Robbie. I think that anybody...
Yeah, don't feel bad.
I mean, anybody who's ever had a hobby could totally understand what you're saying. And
I think I'm just going through
a dry spot right
now.
I've bounced off of video games many times in my life. I've bounced between hobbies. I've got a laundry list of hobbies that I've abandoned throughout the years. You know?
Right. I mean, I love gaming, and I'm sure I always will. I always have since I was pretty young. I think I'm just going through, you know, a lull spot right now.
Yeah, that's okay. And Robbie, if you ever need anybody to talk to, I know a few guys who run a frisbee throwing podcast. So if you do want to get outside and start throwing a frisbee, just let me know. You can.
Are you talking about ultimate frisbee? You talk about frisbee?
I want a tetherball podcast.
I'm talking about ultimate.
That's
God.
I mean, that's probably quite an interesting topic in itself, Robbie, to have a quick discussion on. Do you feel like part of it could be down to the fact that there's so many games out at the moment? I mean, so many good big games that you just almost feel spoilt, like,
or I'm overwhelmed.
Do I have time to get into any of them? You know, like, because you played Mass Effect for a while as well.
I have Mass Effect too. I haven't. Kate started playing it. I saw her start it. I saw the character creation in the first hour or so, and it looks like crap. And she
back to what Gary was saying to Robbie. I'm actually interested in this.
Yeah, so it's just the idea of, you know, being overwhelmed by games, because I think we've all felt that where we've stared at our, you know, wrapped versions of Far Cry and thought, is it something that I really want to get into now? So do you think that could be contributing to it for you, Robbie?
Yeah, I think so. I think I'm just going through an interesting time right now. And yeah, like I think it's been a couple months now, really any game I've played, it's any game. Like, it doesn't matter what it is. I'll play it for a little bit and I'm just not feeling it. I don't know. I think I'm just,
Let me just chime in real quick, Robbie. And let me say this about Robbie Breyer. Gary, you could probably agree. Robbie has been known to play every single game that comes out, every AAA title. He plays them. He has them completely beat by the time we do the show. No matter if the game came out that Friday.
Not lately, though.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. You've done this for the last couple of years with every type of AAA game. I think that maybe you've burnt yourself out. And on top of that, there's just myriad games to play.
Besides just burnout, there's also just a lot. I don't know. I don't want to get into Robbie's personal life. Let Robbie talk about it if he wants to.
Okay. I appreciate that.
You know, as Robbie grows up, he's transitioning from... No.
Boyhood to manhood.
Yeah,
that's the other thing too. I mean, I'm a grown up now too. When I was a teenager, I mean, I used to just game all night, all day long. I mean, I still, like I said, I love gaming. It is something I am very passionate about, and I love this hobby. But
yeah,
I guess I'm just getting older, and I'm starting to do more stuff. And
won't be long till you're out there with some knickerbockers and, you know, a collared shirt, hitting the links, you know, hitting the golf ball around.
I mean.
Just to
reassure you, Robbie, it's perfectly normal for it to grow hair. It's not unusual. Everyone gets it.
Oh my gosh.
It happens.
He's been really frustrated about it too, Gary. Brian didn't want to talk about Robbie's issues, and you done brought it out for everybody.
There's my personal life right there. It's okay. The hair will grow. You got to be patient.
You got to be patient. One day. You know.
That was a good one. That caught me by surprise.
That was awesome, Gary.
No, jokes aside, mate, like Brian said, no shame in it. I mean, I think if anything, it's something to bring to the podcast. You know, you're here because you love gaming. You're here because you've got a great voice
gaming. I know I will.
But it's just interesting that even someone that has it as a passion in themselves can feel that burnout. So,
for sure. I felt that burnout in many of my hobbies. Golf, you know, I was joking about golf just a second ago. I played golf every day.
For how long?
I don't know, 5 to 10 years, somewhere in the middle there. And at some point, 10 years. It became a chore, and I stopped playing. I get more enjoyment out of it now because I go once a year.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
That's incredible.
Yeah.
Mm. It must have been one of those dark joys. You've never spoken about it in all these years. So, yeah, wow.
Yeah. I love the game, but it became, you know what it was? I got so competitive at it that every time I missed a shot, it became what I focused on instead of all the good stuff, you know, all the great shots.
Yeah, I've had that feeling.
It happened to Colin Moriarty, Robbie. It can happen to you. You know, when you do something for so long, sometimes your mind, your heart needs a break from it.
Maybe I do need a bit of a break.
To recollect yourself and focus on other things, maybe. So just let us know when you're back. You know, when Robbie comes back and says, I beat 8 games this week, guys, and I'm going to talk about them all.
Mm-hmm.
Then we'll know he's back. Absolutely. Take your time, my friend. Breyer, what have you been playing this week?
Clearly Destiny. we're still wrapped up in the Age of Triumph. It's funny what Gary was saying about a possible, you know, link to too much to do has actually been affecting me in Destiny. It's like I boot up Destiny and there's 4 raids to complete on 3 characters. So that's a total of 12 raids to do per week. There's Trials of Osiris. There's the Nightfall. There's all of the Age of Triumph book stuff to fill out. And I've been, to a T of what Gary just said, I've been feeling like locked up with too many choices in Destiny, which is a good problem to have. But it's like, what do I really want to do here? And I end up doing nothing.
So would you say that is a good problem to have? So my devil's advocate to that would be that procrastination is common amongst humans. It's a problem we all have. If you give us too much choice, we won't pick anything. So could it be that Destiny now has not really set a clear value proposition? They've said, here's everything to do, but none of it is compelling enough to make you want to play that. Briar's trying to use pussy to get clickbait at the moment. So that's what we're doing for anyone that's not watching it. He's just flashing pussy on the webcam.
Flashing the pussy across the screen.
Anyone that's screening. To the point, Brian, do you think that Destiny's not created a strong enough value proposition to make you think, I am definitely not missing that this
week?
That's
a great argument. Wow. Never thought of it like that.
To me, there is value, right? I definitely want to be doing all of the raids. I want to be doing the Nightfalls. I want to be doing all of it. I don't see it as a lack of value. I see it as everything having equal value, and I just can't decide what to do. So I ended up just like running strikes for fucking 6 hours.
Makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Which is progressing me because I have to get the Doom to get the book done. But it's weird. It's a weird feeling. I've never had this in Destiny. You know, maybe you're right, Gary, because past, there's always been this story. Right, there's this story and a goal at the end of it. Right, when Rise of Iron came out, you know, I wanted to run through the story. I did the story. Then I had my goal, my personal story of getting into that raid at as high of light as I could. So my first 3 days of Rise of Iron were just like grind, get into that raid, finish that raid. Then the next one was hard mode raid. I want to, you know, grind, get into that hard mode raid. And then, you know, it's PvP and it's Trials of Osiris. Because after I come out of a raid, I'm like, oh, okay, that's PvE. Now let's check out PvP. Right now, it's just like, it's like across the board. There's so much to do. But there is no, like, singular story goal, I guess. Yeah, there's no story for me to go after either.
I'm not a hater on Destiny. I love the game. I think it's fun to play. Definitely there. My observation there was just thinking, if you sat down and reflected on exactly why you're playing it, and I mean, why do we play anything? I mean, there's no point to anything except the enjoyment of doing it. But in reality, if we're absolutely transparent about it, at the moment there is no carrot in Destiny. There's nothing you're chasing. You're playing it to play it.
That's what I was saying. It seems like
items inside Destiny that I still want.
But what do you do once you have all the items? Will you be done?
I mean, there is a completionist nature to it. I completely hear you. And like, there's fun in doing it.
As many times as I've run Trials on my Titan, I've still never gotten the fucking Trials Titan helmet. Like, it drives me crazy. Every time I see a drop on my Titan, I'm like, why can't it ever be the helmet? It's never dropped for me. So that's one of the things I always want to do trials on my Titan. The raids, you know, we just got all the raids redone. I really want to get a legendary Fatebringer. Haven't gotten it yet. Really like to get the Vex Mythiclast. Haven't gotten it yet. Really like to get, you know, legendary versions and exotic versions of all the weapons. Most of the exotics I've gotten, but legendaries are almost like the Vision of Confluence, the, you know, the Fatebringer. These things are actually pretty valuable to me. But there is also this kind of feeling that Destiny 2 is right on the horizon. You know, as we get that beta is soon. It's coming soon. There's going to be a point in time where we've played Destiny 2, but we can't play it anymore.
Oh,
and there's
going to
be this in-between time where we have to go back to Destiny, and that's going to be fucking brutal.
I mean, you guys are relatively savage around my Vita recommendation in 2017, so I'm going to be savage about your pet game here. If you weren't a content creator for Destiny, so you were part of the community now, like us here, we play the game because we enjoy it. Would you still be playing it as frequently as you are now?
Probably not. No, because financially I'm linked to it in some extent. I would still be raiding. I don't think I'd ever be doing like raid helps though at this point.
Right.
I would never be getting on LFG with like some friends and saying, let's try and find somebody who's never done the raid. That ship sailed for me a long time ago. I would still be playing it, especially the PvE side. And I still enjoy PvP. God, Gary, I think I would, actually. The honest answer is yes, because I actually fucking enjoy.
There you go.
I was playing with Hove and Wilson earlier today. And I was like, do I really want to stream this? Or do I just want to sit there and have a good time with Hove and Wilson and play some Trials? And I ended up streaming it, but there's been many times over the weeks where I've played Trials like on a early Saturday morning and I'm not streaming it. There's no financial gain for me for playing Destiny at that point. Just hanging out with Skinny or I'm hanging out with Wilson or I'm hanging out with Mega and we're just playing some Trials and fucking giggling our asses off.
Yeah. Sounds to me like you've answered the question about the value proposition then in what you've said implicitly. I guess it's the community and the friendships that you have and the way in which you've, you know, you've maintained them through. Is the activity sort of secondary to the fact that you've got those friendships there and you have great time when you're playing with them? So definitely, I guess that's where the value proposition remains in Destiny.
Wow, way to decompartmentalize it and put it all together, Gary. Way to go. Yeah. Bravo, man.
Damn,
that came out of nowhere, but it was really, wow. That was very interesting. Thank you for bringing that up and really going in depth with that because now I see how fucked up Briar really is.
Okay. I'm
going to
drink myself.
All right, so.
Your glass full of whiskey, so you're good.
I finished it.
It's over now. We got us a little bit of news for episode 152. Robbie, would you like to get us started?
Absolutely, guys. Let's get it started off. So, Call of Duty World War II has been officially announced this week in development by Sledgehammer Games and due for release on November 3rd, 2017 for PS4, Xbox One, and PC. A full reveal of the game will happen on Wednesday, April 26th at 10 a.m. Pacific Time during a live stream. Additional details have revealed details about the campaign, multiplayer, and a brand new co-op mode for the World War II shooter, along with details of a multiplayer beta.
Who's excited about this, man?
I am somewhat excited about it.
Yeah.
I'm excited about this game. I think this is taking it back to its roots and everything that made people fall in love with Call of Duty. They're going to have it again, and then they're going to add some added gameplay mechanics. I mean, hopefully no double jumps and strafing through the air, but I think it's going to be boots on the ground. Yep. I don't think there's going to be any flying drones or anything like that. It's going to be just hardcore warfare, and I think that's what a lot of people have been asking for. I'm excited for this.
Oh, that gritty old school World War II. I am like, just the potential of this game for me is exciting because, you know, we've talked about Call of Duty needs to change. We've talked about that a lot. You know, we're tired of the future. I was definitely getting burnt out.
Needs to change
too.
Back.
Yeah.
Back to the way it used to be. It needs to change again. Yeah. But like, it just got so burnt out. Like even Infinite Warfare, I played the multiplayer. I'm like, this is just not good. Like, I just don't like this. Call of Duty has lost its identity, and this is going back to what it, even before Call of Duty 4, when it became popular. Like, this is something that's been away for a long time, And I know that I love Battlefield 1 when that came out. It felt so different and so fresh. And I love World War history, and I love those weapons, and I love just everything about that time period. So if they can make a fun shooter out of this, I mean, I am just really excited. They could really make a great game here.
Yeah. I think Activision. I'm sorry, go ahead, Gary.
I was just going to say that that news article, I read around it as well and had a look. And there's two things that are really, really piquing my interest. And I don't know what you guys feel about those. One being the descriptions about the campaign, mm-hmm. in that it looks mm-hmm. like it's likely to start with a beach landing. And then
Normandy.
And then we'll travel across Europe with a compelling human story that will link you to the troops that you're with in new and interesting ways that we've not seen before in Call of Duty. You may well care about the colleagues and comrades that are killed, mm-hmm. or not so. I don't know what's going to happen with it. And secondly, and the more important part, I might be really out of touch with it, but has Call of Duty had a co-op mode with a unique story in it before?
Not that I'm aware. No. I guess you could call zombies that, couldn't you, at some point? Like, there are...
Yeah,
story elements to some of the zombies, but not, I don't think, like what you're saying.
They've had Spec Ops before. It wasn't Spec Ops.
That wasn't a story mode at all.
Yeah, that was just random missions.
Yeah.
So the fact that you can now get together with your buddies, and we don't know if this is two-player, three- or four-player co-op, might be a whole squad, and every person mm-hmm. then in this story mission is going to be another one of your buddies, and you really feel like you're in the trenches together. Well, not trenches, but you're in the, you know, you're in the battle together. To me, that's unique, and that's something that could put Call of Duty on the map.
It sounds cool. Correct me if I'm wrong, though. If it is, you know, a wave of enemies spawns in, you got to kill all the waves, and then move up 5 feet and another wave. If I'm doing that with one person or if I'm doing that with four people, fuck it. I'm done with that Call of Duty. You got to change that method up, because I have not had any interest in a campaign of Call of Duty in a very long time because of it.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but didn't Advanced Warfare have we could run through the campaign together? Didn't we do that, guys? I'm pretty sure
that we... Yeah, you might be right. Advanced Warfare might have had...
Advanced Warfare did. I remember playing... it was four. It was four players.
No, that was Black Ops 3, not Advanced Warfare. That was Black Ops 3.
Are you sure?
Yeah. I remember we played it a little bit.
Okay, well, I know we ran through it all together, so that is something that's been kind of existing in the previous games. And maybe they'll, you know, get it down pat this time. But I'm excited for it. I mean, I can't wait to look at the success of Battlefield 1. You know, I think that Activision saw that and they're like, okay, people really want this, you know, old school kind of first person shooter, and Call of Duty kind of breathed life into that initially. They were the originators of that kind of gameplay. And so they decided to go back and see and try their hand at it. I think they're going to be successful with it.
Yeah, I'll be honest with you. As always with Call of Duty, I'm really only interested in the multiplayer. And if they can have some sort of a compelling multiplayer experience again, which in my I think they haven't had one since Ghosts, and I'm of the minority. A lot of people think it goes farther than that, you know?
Yeah.
So, like, if they could somehow figure out a way to have a compelling multiplayer experience, I'll be happy to play some Call of Duty next year. I don't know that if that formula for a game really holds up for me anymore after in a post-Destiny world where all of those pieces are linked into one cohesive package, where I feel like my character is the same character that goes into PvP or PvE or raids or strikes or whatever. You know, like, to me, that Call of Duty formula of having here's a zombie mode, here's a multiplayer mode, and here's a single player mode, I don't know if that really works for me anymore.
Everything seems to be compartmentalized. Yeah, you want it to all be cohesive and be one singular experience with different avenues. I got you.
That's the thing, actually, too, because they said in that press release, or not press release, the leak as well, for multiplayer, there's going to be new social ways to interact with people, which you can take that any way you want, but that's an interesting thing, too. How are they going to do that?
And I think as well, there's a big wild card out at the moment, and that's Destiny 2. We're all assuming it's going to be as good as or better than Destiny 1. That's a big if. We don't know that, you know. There's no yardstick to measure this Call of Duty against. So it could be that we're looking at a big flop for Destiny in September and a big hit for Call of Duty in November. I hope not. I hope they're both successful.
They'll both be successful. I think so. Yeah.
But, you know, we don't know that yet. So let's not look at a foregone conclusion that Destiny has this magic formula. Destiny 1 did, yes, but we don't know what Destiny 2 is yet.
Totally.
All right. So moving forward, we guys have we've seen video games become kind of a staple of modern society, and apparently it's changing even with the Olympics. For the first time ever, esports will be a featured event at the Olympic Games in both 2018 and 2022.
Yep.
That's a big deal.
True story.
What do you think, Briar? You know, you see your favorite esports players at the Olympics.
I'm all about esports. I love watching esports, but...
Gold medal, oh. Briar. Gold medal. I mean,
checkers isn't at the Olympics. Chess isn't at the Olympics.
I guess it's way more competitive than those, though. I mean, I don't know.
Fuck off! It's more competitive than chess. No,
chess is really nothing more competitive than chess, Robbie.
Yeah. I feel like...
Asia, that's how you take it.
They've stacked the odds somewhat in their favor, though, because the two divisions that it's going to be competing is the RTS and the MOBA divisions. So you're looking at League of Legends and you're looking at StarCraft.
Yeah, games I personally don't care to watch.
I think it should be more like a pentathlon where they got to compete in one athlete has to compete in a bunch of different activities.
That's how they should do it.
Here's, you know, today is Call of Duty, and while you're playing Call of Duty, you've got to have your left hand playing a MOBA.
Yeah. There's the real athletes for you.
Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, this is really not surprising to me that Asia would look to promote the genres in which they have huge success already and massive market entry. If this was, as you say, first-person shooters, survival games, a whole range of different
things. Yeah, that would appeal
things.
Here, more specifically. Yeah,
So these are official... parts of the Olympics now? It's not like a test trial or like a
No,
exhibition.
It is going to be like a test trial for 2018, but it may become an Olympic, like actual medal sport later on. There's sort of, you know, it's just a featured event.
But sports are added all the time into the Olympics. This isn't unusual. Sports are trial to see if there's the success, the coverage, and then brought in and out. So yeah. Esports are being added, and esports within the RTS and the MOBA genres.
I mean, equestrian so is in there, so I guess anything can be, right?
Dancing horses. Dancing horses.
Who's really the athlete here, huh?
Yeah. Rhythmic gymnastics, just waving a ribbon. Done. Anyway.
I mean, it's interesting, too, because even if we had Olympic Games here, because Call of Duty and stuff is already an Olympic sport. Well, not really an Olympic sport. It's at the X Games, though. It's a real sport there. It's considered a big thing. And, I mean, personally, I don't
think this just shows that all of these things are just motivated by money.
Absolutely.
That's know, like there's exactly
no
what
other explanation for calling these things sports, either X Games or Olympics. They just want a piece of that pie.
Any of these, it's like we'll introduce them if we think, you know, of course, yeah, they can make money. That's the main reason.
I tell you what, MOBAs and RTS in Korea, those guys go hard. I mean, have you seen the scars on the forearm? That those guys had.
Yeah, there's been guys who.
You gotta get a better wrist rest. What the fuck's going on over there?
No, this is true. This is God's honest truth. The professional RTS and MOBA teams out there, they have the guys working 12 to 14 hour days, clicking away. And the RSI that they get, it's like a mark of honor that you've passed. You know, you're a legacy veteran in the team. They have to have RSI operations. They've got sort of 6-inch scars down their forearms. That's I'm just saying, those guys go hard. You know, can't really diminish them from what they do.
Arthritis and carpal tunnel.
RSI is not the same as like working out. I guess it is the same.
It is. It's a skill set.
It's a skill set for sure. I don't know if you can call it athletic though.
Yeah.
What about I mean, it snooker? Blurs the line, right? That's snooker, where esports are controversial to people. It's like, is it real sports? Is it not? Personally, I'm going to say I don't think it matters. I don't have an issue with esports. I enjoy watching them.
I do too.
More
Robbie.
Like Call of Duty and stuff. I think that's entertaining. I think that's awesome that there can be a place for that if people want it. I think
that's great.
And that's it, really.
As the only black guy on the podcast, if NASCAR is a sport, then esports is a sport.
I think so. Yeah. I think it is.
NASCAR, not in the Olympics.
It's a different type of sport.
Not yet. They're going to get pissed off when they see Call of Duty there.
I'm triggered, man. Did you just assume my race?
Right?
I think you did.
Oh, I know.
I know you're Asian, Gary. Come on.
We see that yellow skin on you. Yeah.
So,
okay.
What?
I thought you were from fucking Canada, man. All right. So.
For any Asian listeners, we do not endorse the views of Robbie here. He is Canadian.
I'm sorry. I should apologize because, you know. I am Canadian. I'm sorry. Yeah. I went too far.
Listen, this news is actually exciting, and I'm sure a lot of you guys have heard about it. And thank you to Briar for telling me earlier before the show about where I can get the Classic NES Mini tomorrow. Hot off the news of the discontinued NES Classic Edition, sources via Eurogamer claim a Super Nintendo Classic Edition will be released this fall.
Yeah, I think no doubt that'll happen. It seems pretty obvious. Ooh, there's the original for you.
This is how it fits in your hand. I want something that really fits in my hand. I want a Classic Mini.
We talked about this a couple of weeks ago when it got announced that the NES was going to get discontinued, and we were all shocked by it. One of the ideas I had was maybe they were going to do like a seasonal thing. Like once a year, they come out with another one of these things, and it just becomes a collector's 64. Item. So this year, do you think that would indicate that is kind of their plan, is to just do one of these once a year? You know, it's available for a short time, and then it's gone forever?
Almost certainly now, yeah.
It's a cool idea. I know a lot of people are pissed off that they didn't get an NES, me included, actually. I'm sad. You know, I told Beasley that tomorrow...
Don't tell everybody, Briar. Tell them the day after
Best Buy is actually getting a shipment tomorrow, and I'm going to go to Best Buy and see if I can get one.
Me too.
Beasley said the same thing. I really want one of these things, but it does add some cachet, you know, the fact that they are going to be these limited edition things, and it's kind of a bummer that not everybody can get one. But it's kind of a cool thing, too, isn't it?
Well, for me, it's going to be just strictly for collectors. I'm not even going to open mine. I'm just going to sit on the counter, and it's going to be something I give my kids in 400 years when I finally die.
I hate people like you. I hate that. It's the worst. It's like having like a muscle car in your garage that you never drive. Like you
everybody who has a muscle car does that, and the ones who drive it, fuck them up.
No, man. The coolest people drive their muscle cars because it's a cool fucking thing to drive around.
That's why you never see him, because there's not that many fucking cool people around, Briar. Okay?
So, why do we care about this NES Classic and SNES Classic? Why do we want one?
I think that the Super Nintendo Classic for me is a much better value proposition for me. I had more fun with the Super Nintendo than I did with the Nintendo, and that's something that I feel like it's a modern take on it, even though it's old games. Hopefully they can put more than 30 games on it. And I'm just excited to see what they're actually going to stick on this thing. I think it'll be great to see A Link to the Past. It'll be great to see games like Donkey Kong Country.
That's Super a Mario value All-Star. Proposition, right? For like 50, how much are these things? 50 bucks?
60. Yeah.
60 bucks. You get 30 games plus That's two huge. Controllers. Is it two controllers?
One
controller. Yeah. And it's like With a real NES cord. Controller. Well, like, I think it's a pretty good value proposition.
This is one thing I will say that I hope that Nintendo is able to fix this time around, is that the controllers, the cords are not this long.
Yeah.
They need to have at least 6 to 8, 6 foot cords. Give people enough room that they don't have to sit in front of the TV, man.
Yeah. Retailers need to start doing one per customer, too.
Well, who knows if they will, man. I mean, I'd grab two if they let me tomorrow.
My view on the value proposition here was that these things would be something that the non-gamer would pick up. Mm-hmm. So, you know, the parent, the person who maybe was a lapsed gamer who'd played in their childhood, had a NES. These are the type of thing that you'd see as you're leaving the store. Hey, pick it up, $50, get it, you know, nice and done. Personally, I can't see the value proposition for us as gamers. I mean, surely, one, these are games you've played and games you own elsewhere on virtual consoles. And two,
I have the actual cartridges, but man, I mean, some people don't have games like Turtles in Time. There's a whole generation of people who never played Super Nintendo. Yeah, it's a huge value.
The comments right now, you know, to get an SNES console would cost you $50. He's right about that. Link to the Past, if you want to get a cartridge version, it'll be $20 to $30. You know, yeah, you can play it on virtual console, but you're playing it on new controllers, not the old classic controllers. You can get a Retron 5 and buy the cartridge and do it that way. What's nice about this thing, though, is they have HDMI outs. It's all one unit. You got 30 games on there.
It's official product.
Plug it in, play it, and you're playing on the original controller. You know, I think they're pretty cool. It's not a life changer. If I have to, you know, if I have to play A Link to the Past on my Switch instead, you know, I'm not gonna be crying tears, but I wouldn't mind having it.
We spoke about the wealth of games available to you at the moment, quality games, new modern games, and not having enough time to play them. Do we really need to bring 30 more classic games in, and are you going to play them if you had it?
If they put the right games on the Super Nintendo Mini, I would definitely play that. I mean, there's a lot of games that are classics from that era that I don't actually physically own. And if they were able to put that on there, I'd be able to, you know, give my kids more history and be able to delve back into the games I loved when I was a teenager. So, yeah, for me, I definitely do it. They are classic games. There's tons of games around us right now, but are they going to end up being classic, time-tested games? Probably not. But the games that are going to be on the Super Nintendo Mini more than likely already are. So, yeah, I think I definitely play them.
If they put Street Fighter 2, Street Fighter 2?
Yes, Super Street
Mario
Fighter.
Mario World.
Mario Kart.
To the Blast. Mario Kart I could live without. That's
yeah,
such an archaic right. version of that game.
You're
now.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, we have better versions of that.
Mario All-Stars.
Would be on there.
Mario All-Stars.
Mario All-Stars would be kind of cool.
Ninja Gaiden Trilogy.
Nah.
You fucked up, Briar.
But I mean, there are some games on there that I would just love to play again.
Donkey Kong Country? You wouldn't play that?
Oh, fuck that game.
Oh, man. You know,
people are going to be angry.
That game is so overrated. It is so overrated. That game controls like shit. It looked good. It looked good.
And
that's all I had going. No, it didn't.
The controls were spot on in that game. You just didn't know how to fucking play it. And you need to listen to aquatic ambience when you drive around the hood. People have no idea what it is. But
you have been fooled by your own memories.
I've never played it.
No, I haven't.
Basically, what did Digital Foundry say about Donkey Kong Country?
I didn't catch that one. I'll go back and watch it after the show.
Just ask him.
NBA Jam, Hugo in the chat with NBA Jam.
That would be good. That'd be a good game. I want Super Castlevania 4, but you know, I'm probably in the minority there.
I'm getting roasted in the comments right now.
You are?
That game is not as good as you guys remember.
Yeah, you guys smash it, man. Donkey Kong Country was an amazing game.
I know people love it.
It was more like Little Big Planet than Mario.
Are you out of your mind?
Just saying, it didn't control as good as like a Mario game.
It controlled like Donkey Kong, but it was the controls were tight. It's not like you really made mistakes. You just didn't know how to play.
No.
You know, and it's okay not to know, Briar.
I beat the game. But that was because I rented it, and I beat it. Like beat every game I rented back in the day.
I feel like either of you are about to punch your monitor right now.
I feel like we should step aside. 1v1 me on Russ, Beasley. We'll settle this like men.
Ultimately, Donkey Kong Country.
Quick scopes.
Donkey Kong Country may or may not be a classic, but I think we can all agree that Just Dance is a modern masterpiece. And apparently, Ubisoft is opening two new AAA development studios to help in the creation of franchises like Just Dance. What do we think about that, Robbie?
I mean, yeah, basically they're opening Ubisoft. Two studios in Europe, Ubisoft Bordeaux and Ubisoft Berlin, just in case.
I love the name of that, Ubisoft Bordeaux. What kind of highfalutin games are coming out of Ubisoft Bordeaux?
You know, in case like 10 studios on one game wasn't enough, now you're going to have 12. So there you go. That's my opinion on it. Like, they have so many studios already working on
it. Believe it or not, Just Dance is like a phenomenon. So many people play it. I've never owned one. But I know a lot of friends and family who own it and have played it, you know, over the last few generations. And it's exciting to a lot of people. But Ghost Recon, I'm not sure. I have it. I've played 1 hour, Gary. And Steep, I have no clue what that is.
I think Robbie was a fan Steep of Steep, wasn't he, Robbie?
Yeah, it's the Steep one where the whole game is on the mountain. Game. Yeah, it's all extreme it sports on a mountain.
Yeah.
Nothing amazing.
Yeah, I mean,
if that game ever drops to like $15, I'll probably buy it.
I mean, Just Dance is, you guys are lost. You need to get Just Dance and get some groove in your life.
Man,
I don't disagree. To be honest with you, that kind of shit is hilarious and fun to play, especially if you're like, you got a few drunk friends around.
Oh, yeah.
But I really feel like you're doing it wrong if you don't get like the Dance Dance Revolution full arcade setup for your living room, right? I mean, no, you're really just half-assing it unless you really go all out.
It's hard to find those, Briar. I still have the dance pads under my sofa here.
Uh-huh.
And I break out the PS2 and play DDR Max 2 every now and then.
You need to video that.
No. I'll never.
You need to stream that live, Beast.
I'm actually good, man.
I'm not doubting. I want to see.
You guys are lost. I'm authentic with it, so I don't need friends. I don't need anything like that. I've got a wall of mirrors. I've got hot pants and I've got leg warmers.
Last words, Gary.
That's it. Wall of mirrors, hot pants and leg warmers, and I just get my foot loose on, you know, done.
15 Gary's all
I just got a semi. I don't know about you guys.
Amazing. Everybody cut loose. That's the what we do.
All right, so continuing on with our news. I don't know why this is in the news, but I guess Robbie was looking. The Xbox game. The Xbox Games with Gold for the month of May have been announced. They include Gianna Sisters, Twisted Dreams, and Lara Croft in the Temple of Osiris for Xbox One, and Star Wars The Force Unleashed 2 and Lego Star Wars The Complete Saga for 360.
Not an amazing month. It's Force okay, Unleashed though.
2 was it? That was a good game. I like the Force Unleashed series. That was interesting.
The Force Unleashed 1 was the shit. 2 was not nearly as good. The Force Unleashed 1 was amazing. And this
I actually missed that. Is that worth going back to?
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh man, Starkiller, man. Woo! It was just great.
I like me some Star Wars, but I hate me some prequels. So, like, is this prequel or is this real Star Wars?
It's not prequel. It's post Vader, and you are Vader's apprentice.
What I mean is it shitty or is it good?
It's great. It's great. Okay. It's great. It's definitely great. You need to definitely check them out.
It could have been a film series on its own. It's a really interesting premise.
Really?
Absolutely.
Maybe it will be. You know, like something like Rogue One.
Well, it'd be difficult to fit in canon-wise.
Yeah?
Yeah. It's a challenging thing, unless it was completely abstract. Well, you know what
they could
do?
They could pretend that the prequels never happened. Would it fit in better then? There we go. We got a solution. LucasArts, call me.
Brian's got to play the game first to sell you the idea. This is actually exciting news for me because I've watched this, you know, people streaming it, and it's the kind of game that I like. But one thing bothers me about this Friday the 13th game is that it seems very similar to Evolve, where it's 4 versus 1. But Friday the 13th, the crowdfunded game, will launch on May 26th for PS4, Xbox One, and PC for $40. The game will launch with a 1v7 asymmetrical multiplayer. An update this summer will bring a single-player campaign to the game free of charge.
This looks like, what is the name of that game? Is it Dead by Daylight or?
Dead by Daylight, yeah.
Yep. That game looks fun to play. I hope it's like a little bit more of a finished version of that kind of a.
It's like the same game almost.
Yeah. It does look like the same game.
Very similar.
I don't know if this is going to be like Evolve with the whole one overpowered person monster character against a lot of other people.
Well, Jason can teleport like anywhere. He pulls up a map and he can see you running off in the distance. He can teleport to predestined positions on the map. So it's just like the Jason movies where you're running from this guy.
Yeah,
when you turn
up
the corner, he's right in front of you. And you're like, holy shit. And then you're constantly trying to get away. So to me, that whole aspect works really well. I'm excited to try it. I think I'll definitely be picking this up. I'm a huge fan of the old Friday the 13th films as well. So
it looks cool. Yeah.
It looks cool. It looks almost as good as Breath of the Wild, but it still looks cool.
I don't know. The best horror game I've played recently was something called Yomiwari, which is actually only a 3 to 4 hour game for the Vita. Let's get this back in, but it's also available on Steam. It's on Steam as well for anyone that cares.
I need the title because I won't have to pick that up. I'm a huge horror fan.
Yomiwari. Phonetically. Yeah. It's a survival horror game, top-down isometric, about a little girl who loses her dog and her sister in a town, her hometown, that gets possessed by demons. If you're a horror fan, I definitely recommend looking at Yomiwari. The game is only 3 to 4 hours to complete, but it's 3 to 4 hours of heart-wrenching terror and emotional torment. It's physically wearing through, but yeah, pick up
Yomiwari. And don't mind the pussy that just flashed across the screen either. That's just, you know, that's standard for the show.
Hey, look, man, I got three. You know, we can start competing and shit. One of them's a dude, but hey.
I'm just trying to keep her away from eating my headphone cables, man. She's gone through 3 already.
Oh, no.
Ooh, my cat's going to become a soccer ball soon.
Yeah.
All right, what do we got next?
This is the news that Gary added. Spanish retailer Extra Life is advertising the upcoming Xbox Scorpio console with a $399 price tag. That's roughly 350...
Euro. Right.
I'm sorry, Gary.
€399.
Okay, so, and I'm guessing that this is £335 in the UK?
That's pounds.
Yeah, so let's assume it's $450 for argument's sake.
So this is a placeholder price that they're advertising this for. So we're looking at $450 for the Xbox codename Scorpio. Do you guys think this could be, actually happen?
Very compelling, isn't it?
It'd be very compelling, Briar. And you know, Gary, Robbie, you and I would all be immediately picking it up for that price.
Yeah. Oh, for sure.
From what we've heard, the power that this thing holds is just much more expensive than $450. So I'm trying to figure out exactly how much of a loss, if this were true, would Microsoft be taking on each console sold?
Yeah.
I think Phil Spencer's not a naive man, and I think he's been doing everything right for Xbox moving forward. I think Xbox understand that at the moment they're not in a position to call the shots and set the market price. I think they understand that they need to sell hardware units. And if this is a way to sell hardware units, you know, I think the market was excited if they said, well, $499 will be a compelling price. If they're able to get it out there at, you know, $450, you know, suddenly you've got people interested, and this thing's going to shift units regardless of whether or not it's got the exclusives. So I don't know. My view is that we could well see this as a reality. It's a headline. Mm. You know?
It's earth-shattering news. I wonder if this actually comes to play, what'll be Sony's next card to play? Because that'll make the competition even more fierce. If people can pay that much money and be so close in parity to the PS4 Pro and have something that's much more powerful, that's going to really shake the foundation of what PlayStation's been building, in my opinion, especially for people who are more interested in power than exclusives. You know, it sounds like a very fickle and shallow argument, but people like exclusives and people like power, and I guess it all depends on who wants what.
Yeah. Oh, man. I still think $499 is the most likely price for Scorpio, because I can't see them going much lower than that, just based on how much loss they'd be taking. If they hit $449, though, that just seems so much better to me than $499. Like, there's something about that price that just seems awesome. It does sound good. Man, I don't know.
Imagine if they hit $400, though.
Oh, God.
That would be unreal.
Imagine if they could do it.
Oh, my God.
No,
like, what does that do to PlayStation 4 sales?
It stifles them immediately.
Yeah, that's huge if they can hit that.
You talk about a marketing strategy.
It stifles them immediately. The only people who would be buying a Pro would be people who only want an exclusive. So, I mean, people who want multiplats, none of them would buy the PlayStation.
I mean, it's an interesting idea, but being completely realistic, even at $450, they're still underselling this hardware price-wise. Yeah. They're not covering the cost of it. And I think you've still got what's the PS4 Pro in dollars now? Is it
$399.
So yep. If there's $50 separating you and you've got double the hardware effectively, I think it's an easier pill to swallow, you know, $50 extra. And I think, you know, the fact that Robbie, as you said in your point there, that, you know, $449 feels better than $499. It's something that immediately resonates with consumers.
It feels so much better.
No, it feels better, though. $399.
That's if look they at get $399. Like that, if they come out at E3 and announce that price, oh my God, I will freak the hell out. That's unreal if they hit that. I just don't expect it.
What about hard drive space? Do you think there's something they could do with this to get it down that low? You think they could do a 500 gigabyte hard drive?
Well, we know they're doing a 1 terabyte. No, not 500. Absolutely not.
How much does a 1 terabyte drive cost? I don't even know if they're available anymore.
I think they are, but it's two. I mean, it's hard to find.
It's going to be a 2.5 inch, so that raises the cost up a little bit. But those things can't cost more than $30, especially if you're getting them in bulk. I bet they're like 15. Well,
you can get them external, so I don't know if Microsoft are going to look at the fact that they've crammed in a 4K Blu-ray player. Can they get away with a 500 gigabyte hard drive and get the price down?
I don't think they can, because they already said it's going to be 1 terabyte, haven't they?
They did.
The dev kit was 1 terabyte. They have not confirmed any specs. Right. We're assuming it based on the thing. The dev kit also had another 1 terabyte solid state drive, so it was 2 terabytes with one of it being an SSD. There's no way that's happening. So we don't know yet. We don't know.
It'd be pretty compelling. 500 gigabytes is a really small hard drive, but if they could do it at $400, man, holy shit, that would be a game changer for Microsoft. I don't really think that. $400 for that console would be outstanding.
Well, that would shock everyone.
USB hard drives, you know, the fact is now you can plug in an external and have the space you want, and people are familiar with that if they've had an Xbox for all these years.
And so, with USB 3, it's almost as fast. Like, it's negligible. Mm-hmm.
Well, let me just say this. You know, I got the PS4 in my living room hooked up. I got the Pro in here. If this had come out...
Why are you lying?
Listen, if this Scorpio had come out before I bought my Pro and it was $450, it would have been an easy decision to buy the Scorpio.
Uh-huh.
It would have been an easy choice because all the PS4 games I want, of course, would have been on the regular PS4.
Right, I was kidding calling you a liar before, but now I know you're lying, because you would definitely be buying a PS4 Pro, Beastly, as would I, for the PlayStation exclusives.
Yeah,
but I already have a PS4. I mean, that's the thing.
Yeah, but that wouldn't be good enough. And you know, in your heart of hearts, man, you're gonna look at Horizon Zero Dawn. And you just got that 4K TV and be thinking, no, this base model PS4 is fine.
Let me just say this, okay? Real quickly, we got a 50 and a 60 in here. They're both 4K, and Horizon on the 50-inch 4K play through a regular PS4 looks incredible. It really does. Uh-huh. It's really. This one has
But you didn't know HDR. That. You didn't have that information. If you only had the base model, you'd be eating away at your soul. Your Sony fanboy supporting soul would just be basically crying and dying inside. Look at you wearing a PlayStation T-shirt.
For God's sakes, beastly.
Okay, I admit it. Fuck the Scorpio.
For people listening on the podcast or aren't watching this on YouTube, can we just confirm, Beastly, what branding do you have on your T-shirt?
It's a PlayStation and my boxers too.
We're
gonna take your word on that one.
I take your word that you would have bought a Scorpio with that T-shirt on, definitely.
I would have.
I'm not saying he wouldn't buy a Scorpio. I'm saying there's no way he's not buying a PlayStation Pro. Like it's just not happening.
I guess we'll never know.
Sorry, go ahead, Gary.
No, go for it.
I don't even know where I was going.
I was going to say, because I can realize now it's a bit incoherent what I've thrown up there. So to cover off and to round up the news, I've got a bit of Nintendo Switch news for you. Mr. Shifty, I don't know if you guys have seen that game that was released. It's very similar to Hotline Miami, but you have the powers of Nightcrawler, where you can teleport through walls. You're kind of stopping a heist.
Oh, I know what game this is.
Buying it today.
I know what this
is. Well, you may or may not when the news gets released this week. Evidence was released that it's the worst platform to play Mr. Shifty on. There's frame rate drops down to as low as 10 frames per second, which really interferes. When you've got a game that relies upon quick minute or second to second action and you're dropping frames like that, you can die quite frequently on it. And it's a pretty unforgiving game.
For anybody who doesn't know what Mr. Shifty is, it is a top down 2D kind of. I don't know, what would you call this? Overhead view, beat 'em up shooter. It looks like, you know, if you're familiar with Project Hotline Miami, it looks exactly like
one of the greatest games I've ever played. To Hotline Miami 1 and 2.
Yeah, this doesn't have the story though.
Really? Oh man.
No. So the developers were approached by angry fans who supported the game on day one to say, "Hey, what's up with the performance here?" And they gave some relatively flippant remarks on Twitter, which were probably not the best thing. I mean, obviously taking a lead from our president and using Twitter as the best way to communicate important messages.
Make Switch great again.
Exactly that. No, they've gone forward with Twitter messages like, you know, remember that even Zelda stutters, or do you know it's also available on Steam and that's maybe a better version for you to
that's
go for.
Fucked up.
That doesn't excuse the Switch version not being good, though.
For sure.
So there was controversy on that way, but to park that controversy aside, I think the developers have subsequently apologized for their relatively lackadaisical attitude to commentary and criticism, and have said that there will be a performance patch which will hopefully address the frame rate drops for the Switch. So what do we think of this?
Well, I think it's very similar to Matrix saying that we do have something for people who can't have an Xbox One. It's called the Xbox 360. Very condescending and disrespectful to people who support. For people who are supporting your brand and supporting your work, you know, the customer's always right, you know? And that's something that...
bullshit.
Hey, man, in a sales world, you're talking to someone who comes from a sales world, that's just the way it is. You've got to approach it from that perspective.
Sometimes they're just assholes, though.
Yeah, they're always
especially
assholes.
Especially on Twitter. Some piece of shit,
yeah. But when you have someone who's, you know, supporting you and supporting your work and you know, they have an inferior product, you've got to try your best to make that situation right rather than come across condescending and make flippant remarks like that. And I think that that's very disrespectful. And if I had known that after buying the game, I would have never purchased anything from them again. So at least they've come out and with the proper response, apologizing, and hopefully they can fix it. And if they do fix it, I'll definitely be buying it because Hotline Miami is one of my favorite games of this generation. It was just a very special experience. And I'd love to see anything.
This is not the same developers as Hotline Miami.
I know, but it's a similar style of game.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, if it's similar in style, I'll still give it a go, you know? You know, if my wife fell off of a cliff and I found another 5'2", short little blonde who played video games, I'd give her a go.
Look, you know, people, people say things, they get riled up. You know, I hesitate to like burn an entire company down because somebody said the wrong shit on Twitter, you know, and somebody was disrespectful on Twitter.
Yeah.
You know, it looks like they are doing the right thing in the end. They're going to optimize it better for the Switch in the end. And it's probably best to, you know, just chill out, wait on it. Hopefully it gets better. You know, it is, I think it is ultimately a good thing that we're seeing digital game returns coming to Xbox One. Hopefully that'll also come to PlayStation. I can't ever honestly see it coming to Nintendo. It just doesn't make any sense. But like, this is the kind of pro-consumer policies that we need these things to adopt so that we do have recourse when we feel lied to, when we feel wronged in some way like this. But yeah, I can't get on board with just like burning a whole company down because somebody misspoke on Twitter.
I hear you.
Gotcha.
Especially with the 144 character limit. So like, was this person? Oh yeah, yeah. I get being upset, but like, let's.
Cool, well,
let's not destroy a company. Yeah. No.
I mean, they didn't even end every tweet with sad as well, which they could have gone with, but hey,
that wouldn't have been a good choice.
Was there gifts? I mean,
sad. Okay. Yeah. Also, we didn't mention it at the start of the show, Brian, but there's a couple of things I'd love to get into the agenda. One being a big apologies for the abrupt ending of last week's show. We lost 20 minutes of the recording.
It was a rough one last week, man.
Yeah. For anyone that's tuned in.
The tech issues were very much my fault. I was trying to record the show and stream it at the same time, using the same computer. And what I didn't realize is that somehow my recording got set to like 40,000 kilobits per second, which is very, very fast and very, very, it's very, very good quality. But trying to do both on one processor was just ridiculous. And so that was all on me. Also, the stream was so delayed that when I cut it off, it was like 15 minutes too quick because it was like streaming out. Yeah. So it was an awful tech issue. I do really apologize for that. We are working on not letting that happen again.
Yeah.
And secondly, for people that want to know, we have not yet had a chance because we lost the last 20 minutes to plug our podcast.
That's right.
And our new place. So I will be linking in the chat the location on Podbean. And I don't know if you guys want to talk about iTunes.
Yeah, for sure, man. iTunes, I mean, we've always called it a podcast, but it's never actually been a podcast.
Technically, yeah. Yeah.
It's kind of funny. So, Gary, I really appreciate it. This is all, you know, Gary's work. Gary's getting this done. He's pulling the audio off of the show. I think actually he's remixed it in the past. Hopefully we can. I've been trying to get it so that he doesn't have to do that. So he can just upload it straight to is it Podbean? And then we've got a website at Podbean, and then it goes from Podbean to iTunes. It's now in iTunes.
Woo! You got it. Finally.
iTunes are letting any old shit on the platform nowadays. I'm going to be completely honest with you.
It shows.
And we are evidence of that.
It shows. You're fucking up iTunes.
Without Steve Jobs around, the quality control has just gone to the shit. Really. So,
bad for Apple. Good for us.
Hey, I like it.
Thank you very much, Gary. I really do appreciate it. This cat is driving me crazy.
It's been great for us, Brian. It's been great for us.
Pussy is ruining the stream.
This is a rule of comedy, Robbie, is that like you can use the joke once, but it's like the fourth time, it's just not funny anymore.
I thought it was still funny. Okay. Mm-hmm.
We haven't had any dick jokes, but Briar has been a dick to that cat all day.
Quick,
so
someone know.
I'm going to murder it.
Well, I mean,
when the tail went by the screen, that was just the greatest. You know, I saw that live. And it was just
so special. Random.
Briar was trying to look like, did they see that? And I'm like, hell yeah.
We all spotted it.
So, I've got wires all over the place, right? Like, it's, I got the soundboard over there, and there's literally like, I don't know, 20 wires like kind of spilling out of this thing. And the cat is just like, it just will not stay away from it. I mean, usually keep the door closed, but somehow it got in. Not on Zune Marketplace. God
Zune,
damn it.
If you have
Zune,
a Zune.
What the hell is Zune?
A Zune is harder to find than the classic NES Mini, man. Put that thing in a box somewhere. Wait,
what's the iTunes like, Gary? Can we post in the chat, too?
I don't have it to hand, but I think you can
just search iTunes for Beastly Thoughts, and I think it pops up.
Yeah, or you can do that. Yeah.
Or you can find us on Podbean, where we have timestamps and interesting website, and you can follow us there and get all the latest updates.
Gary did a nice job on the website, too.
Gary, so beautiful. Yeah.
It is. There's pictures of... Well, if you follow,
I told you we should bring Gary on. Beastly, you fought it like crazy, but now you agree, don't you?
I don't even know if I agree now.
Yeah. No, for everyone that follows the podcast on Podbean, we're promising at least one nude from one of the four of us here. We're not going to say who it is. You have to guess from the nude.
This isn't fair, man, because look, we agreed to this, okay, Gary, but it's not fair because they're going to know it's me when it's me.
No, I'm sure that they'll
get you some
given.
White
I mean,
face. Well, I guess it wouldn't be face, really, technically, but I'm sure we could do something really? With the contrast.
Some white face. Or an Asian, because, you know, we got Gary.
Briar, they're still going to know it's me, even if I turn it bleach white, okay?
You just have that head of chocolate in, yeah.
Get out of here! God damn it!
Yes!
All right, we got to end the show so I can kill my cat.
We do not condone animal abuse. Let me apologize. I'm sorry.
That's not universally true, Robbie.
Before we leave, Brian, how many cats do you have right now?
Two.
All right, so we'll ask you again
next week.
Mark
this show down, man, from what you just said.
Ask that question again next week, is that what you said?
Yes. How many cats you got this week, Brian? Oh, just one.
I killed the rest.
We got one cat. All right,
and
guys.
And it stays out of here.
That's a good show. Like a really good show. I had a lot of fun tonight. Thank you guys very much.
Thank
you. I'm about
to
go play my Switch, baby. I love it.
Yeah, I think I'm going to play a little Zelda tonight, too. I still have got to get some dinner, so that's going to be good.
Oh, I thought you were about to say something else. Okay.
Zelda's not a 10.
What
do you think about this? We'll take a road trip. We'll all get together. Maybe we meet up somewhere. You know, we got to do it kind of centrally located. And I know that's, you know, it's harder for you because you get across an ocean. We'll all get together, and then we will whip Robbie's ass.
Oh!
I don't like this. What?
I mean, I don't know about you guys, but so far, all I've heard on this podcast so far is that he doesn't play games anymore, and he doesn't think Zelda's a 10. Really?
Hey, look, that means his opinion is null and void, my friend. That's what it means in the States anyway.
I'm just kidding, Robbie. I love you, buddy. I really do.
Aww.
Robbie's scared now. You see him? He's really...
Although every time you're whipping my ass, I'll just basically say sorry every single time. I'll apologize for myself.
Canada! I'm sorry!
Every time I get hit, I'm like, I'm sorry!
Alright, this time I'm really ending it. Thank you guys for watching. We'll see you next week.
Next week,
bye, guys. Thank you for watching.
We will be back next week.